Blackstone Audio presents Bandit's Trail, a Western Story by Max Brand. This book is read by Thom Rivera.
Chapter 1. Señor Don Sebastian Valdivia prided himself upon his ability to be all things in all countries. In Rome, he was indeed most Roman. In Paris, he was more Parisian than the French. In England, he could play golf and yawn in the faces of ladies and drink scotch and soda in tall glasses. In Switzerland, he could use an alpine stock where the hardiest ventured and talk the language of every canton in that variegated land. In his own Argentine, he could be the king that his ancient family and his measureless estates entitled him to be. And now that he was in these United States, for the moment, he boasted that he was more democratic than democracy. Since the scene was the great Southwest, where horizons grow wide and men grow big, he was turned out in the very fashion of the hour, or at least his conception of it. Upon his legs were fine leather chaps set off with silver conchas. About his waist was girded a cartridge belt that supported a holster and a pearl-handled colt, which he could use if occasion demanded. Upon his back was a blue silk shirt. His sombrero, with its high-peaked Mexican crown, was banded about with gold filigree. A crimson bandana spotted with green flowed copiously about his throat. His saddle was such a treasure as would have made the heart of any Mexican caballero swell with jealousy, and the horse that he bestrode was a glorious stallion whose thoroughbred strain was dashed with just enough Mustang blood to put a shining devil in its eyes. Riding through the crowd that flocked about the old ranch house, bidding on various items in the long list of the sale, Señor Valdivia carried his 45 years as erectly as any youth and felt himself quite a part of the picture. He would have been most astonished had anyone told him that, compared with the others, he was like the colored fronts piece in a book without other illustrations. Indeed, no one dared even to hint such a fact to such a grandee. And if the rich man noted some differences between himself and the cowpunchers and ranchers in their overalls and well-rubbed coats, he would have attributed it to the natural distinction that exists between men of blood and position and wealth compared with the nameless herd. So he went on his way, sublimely indifferent to the faces around him, attributing their faint smiles and wrinkling eyes to a natural admiration of the striking figure that he made. His secretary, Juan Carreño, rode at his side, dressed like a somewhat tarnished copy of his master, and keeping skillfully half a horse's length behind Valdivia. Señor Valdivia sat his horse at the outskirts of the crowd and watched the bidding on the plows and rusted cultivators and sewing machines and mowing machines and horse rakes. What had cost $150 new now went for $5 to $7, but Señor Valdivia did not bid. The trip to the Argentine might be considered expensive. Besides, he had not the slightest conception of what his huge cattle ranch in that southland might need in the way of implements, and, even if he had, he would not have bothered his head with the buying of them. Such matters were to be left at the discretion of his general manager and that gentleman's assistants. For his part, he had ridden to the sale only because a rumor had reached his ears that valuable horses were to be disposed of here. And horses were the hobby of Señor Valdivia. Señor Valdivia knew them from all angles. He had hunted foxes across the grasslands of England. He had hunted again in wild Ireland on big-boned Irish horses. He had ridden Arabs of ancient blood and shuffling gait across the deserts of their native land. He had wagered his tens of thousands of francs at Longchamp and smiled at his losses. He had wagered his thousands at Epsom and smiled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.